डिसीजेज एंड होम्योपैथी थेरापूटिक्स ऑफ द स्किन, ये बुक है, ये लिखी है जे हेनरी एलन ने। इस बुक में अंदर देखते हैं आगे, तो इसमें टेबल ऑफ कंटेंट्स है, पार्ट वन है। पार्ट वन में सिंपल स्किन के बारे में दिया है, एनाटॉमी, फिजियोलॉजी, सिम्टोमेटोलॉजी, लीजन्स, टियोलॉजी, डायग्नोसिस, क्लासिफिकेशन। उसके बाद पार्ट टू, स्किन से रिलेटेड जो जो कंडीशंस हैं वो सारी पार्ट टू में दिया हुआ है इसमें। इसी तरह उसमें ये इंडेक्स कई सारे पार्ट्स में डिवाइडेड है। और उसके बाद है ये इधर एनिमल पैरासाइट्स दिए हैं, उसके बाद डर्मेटोलॉजिकल थेरापेटिक्स। ये है डिजीजेस ऑफ द स्किन पार्ट वन, जनरल एनाटॉमी एंड फिजियोलॉजी। द स्टडी ऑफ पैथोलॉजी इज अ स्टडी ऑफ द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द टिश्यू और ऑर्गन व्हेन इट इज अंडरगोइंग चेंजेस ड्यू टू डिसीज एज कम्पेयर्ड विद द हेल्दी और नॉर्मल टिश्यू एज अ स्टैंडर्ड। सो इन द स्टडी ऑफ द स्किन नो एक्सेप्शन कैन बी मेड टू दिस रूल, हेंस अ कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव नॉलेज ऑफ इट्स एनाटॉमी एंड फिजियोलॉजी इज नेसेसरी इन ऑर्डर टू फुली अंडरस्टैंड द मैनीफोल्ड चेंजेस दैट टेक प्लेस विद इन इट्स स्ट्रक्चर। इन द मैनी क्लासिफिकेशंस ऑफ द डिजीज we frequently find in each some special tissue involved, and again a number may be involved. It is therefore evident that the study of the normal structure of the skin will materially aid us in the appreciation of its diseases. The integumentum commune forms an external covering for the whole organism and is intimately situated to the structure lying beneath it and continuous with the mucous membrane and the natural orifices. It is firm, fibrous, elastic, its color varying with the age, sex, race and climate. It is thickest on the back, buttock, palm of the hand and soles of the feet, thinnest on the eyelids and prepuce. The surface of the skin is not smooth but shows greater or lesser elevations and depressions due to the presence of furrows or grooves which divide the whole surface into oblong or quadrilateral shaped spaces. Seen more distinctly about the joints and the flexors of the body, their direction being in the direction of the greatest tension of the skin. The pores corresponds to the opening of the hair follicles, the sebaceous and sweat glands. Hairs are present all over the body except on palms of the hand and soles of the feet. The last phalanges of the fingers and toes, glands, penis and inner surfaces of the prepuce. The smaller or almost invisible hairs are called lanugo. The skin is commonly divided into three layers. First, epidermic. Second, corium, derma or cutis vera with the papillae. Third, subcutaneous connective tissue with its adipose. The blood vessels and lymphatics are situated in the latter two layers. The nerves are distributed to all three layers except the uppermost layer of the epidermis, known as the scarf skin. The appendages of the skin are sudoriferous or sweat glands, sebaceous glands, hairs and nails. Minute anatomy. The minute anatomy and the histological elements of these different layers may be briefly considered. First, taking up the epidermis or epithelial layer, it is laminated, slightly elastic membrane composed wholly of epithelial cells and scales containing no blood vessels with a very scant supply of nerve, just a few filaments. It covers the corium everywhere, protecting it from external injury or irritation. Pierced by the hair follicles, the sweat and sebaceous gland, it is marked as before mentioned by a network of minute furrows which represent the depression between the papillae. The epidermis consists of four separate layers. First, stratum corium, second stratum lucidum, third stratum granulosum, fourth stratum mucosum. The first two layers are considered together as the horny layer and the latter two as the mucus layer. But in our pathological study of the skin, it is necessary to study the four separate layers on account of their separate and special involvement in the different diseases we meet. Stratum corium, the external layer, is composed of several layers of flat scales or epithelia, free from nuclei or granulations. They desquamate all through life. and their mode of growth is not yet settled. Stratum lucidum is a thin layer, quite transparent, hence its name, lying directly beneath the corium layer. It consists of from 4 to 6 rows of staff-shaped cells with flattened nuclei. It is frequently called the stratum of oil. Stratum granulosum consists of 2 or 3 rows of flattened nucleated cells, somewhat splinter-shaped, granular around their nuclei. These granulations are supposed to be a substance intermediate in nature between protoplasm and keratin. One author believes the color of the skin in the white race depends on these granules, and that the stratum lucidum is developed from them, as they have the power to strongly reflect the light. Stratum mucosum, stratum malphagi, or stratum mucosum. This layer lies immediately above the corium, separated from it by a thin membrane. It adapts itself into the papillary layer of the corium by means of an interpapillary arrangement, which fits into the depressions composed of several layers of nucleated cells varying in size and shape. The first few layers are columnar with oval-shaped nuclei arranged with their large axis perpendicular to the surface of the corium. The lower layer of the cells are cubiform, polygonal with spatial nuclei homogeneous in their structure, enclosed in a cell wall and contain granular pigmentary matter. The cells of the superficial strata are larger and more granular and become flattened as they approach the surface. The color of this layer is from a yellowish tinge to a brown or black depending on the race. The corium derma or cutis vera is the most interesting layer for study, and it is the most highly organized portion of the skin. It is composed of white fibrous connective tissues arranged in bundles interspersed with a muscular element and yellow elastic fibers. Lymphoid corpuscles, fat globules as well as a true connective tissue cells are found within the closely interwoven spaces. The average thickness is from 1.69 to 2.26 mm, of course, much thicker on the parts before mentioned. The corium contains nerves, lymphatics, hair glands. It is divided into two layers, the upper and lower. The outer layer is called pars papillaris or papillary layer, and the inner layer called pars reticularis. The number of these little papillae that covers the entire surfaces of the body are estimated by Seppi to be 150 lakhs. These papillae are of two varieties, the vascular and the nervous. They contain the terminal loops of the blood vessels and nerves. Pars reticularis. This layer is the fibrous and connective tissue layer forming the bulk of the cutis. The history of its development is embryonic. Life is wonderfully interesting. Subcutaneous tissue is made up of the connective tissue bundles crossing each other and interlacing in such a way as to form rheumatoid spaces. These spaces contain fat globules arranged in lobes separated by fine, delicate connective tissues, well supplied with blood vessels. These adipose elements form cushions which act as protection to underlying structures. It is found more especially in the soles of the feet and palms of the hands, mammary glands, especially after childbirth. Also about the external sexual organs, back and shoulders, besides the blood vessels found in this layer, we also have the coil of the sweat glands, also some of the deeper seated hair follicles. The blood vessels consist of two systems, the deep in the subcutaneous tissue and the superficial immediately beneath the papillae. They are said to be the more numerous in the flexor than in the extensor surfaces of the extremities. The papillae of the hair has its own arteriole which branches into looped capillaries. Nerves are both of a medullated and non-medullated variety which richly supply the skin, usually derived from the subcutaneous branches accompanying the blood vessels. These generally terminate between the epithelium and the rete meticulosum. The medullated nerve fibers end in those strange bodies known as Meissner's corpuscles, commonly known as tactile corpuscles. These tactile corpuscles are little rounded bodies usually situated in the papilla or beneath it. They are quite numerous in the fingertips. They are from 1/250 to 1/300 of an inch long to 1/500 broad. Different varieties being found in the different parts of the body. Sudoriferous glands are small globular shaped bodies, yellowish in color, embedded in the subcutaneous connective tissue and opening with a small duct on the surfaces of the epidermis. They are smaller on the eyelids, nose and largest around the areola of the nipple, the base of the scrotum and axilla. Sometimes they attain the size of 1/10 of an inch. The duct generally emerges between the papillae. They make their appearance in the 5th month of embryonic life. They have a good nerve and blood supply and are found in great numbers all over the body. 2685 are found in a square inch. The length of an uncoiled tube is about 1/4 of an inch. The sum total of crosses numeration in an adult would exceed 9 miles of perspiratory function, which gives us some conception of the importance of this wonderful eliminating process of the much neglected, though nevertheless wonderful, organ of the skin. The secretion of these glands depends somewhat on the location of the gland, which of course modifies the secretion, but it is usually a clear watery fluid. Sebaceous glands, or as they are sometimes called, glands of hair follicles situated in the corium, found from the outer root sheet of the hair. They are divided into three groups. First, those of the scalp, beard and axilla are in the region where hairs are coarse and fully developed. Second, those connected with the lanugo. Third group is where the glands open directly upon the skin and are not connected in any way with the hair follicle. As are found in the external surface of the prepuce behind the corona glandis in the male, and in the female on the surface of the nipple, the vestibule and the labia majora. They vary in size in different parts of the body. Are largest on the eyelids, the meibomium, mons veneris, labia majora, scrotum and anus. They are whitish in color, consisting of an external basement membrane and an internal epithelial lining, and usually open into a hair follicle. The secretion is largely a fatty matter, the hairs. Hairs are modified epithelial tissue, cylindrical, slender in structure and embedded in the depressions of the skin, known as the hair follicle. Each hair is divided into two portions, the root embedded in the skin and the shaft which projects above the skin. They are found all over the body except on palms of the hand and soles of the feet, last phalanges of fingers and toes. Hairs are divided into three classes, long hairs as of the scalp, beard and axilla, second those of the eyebrows and eyelids, and third fine soft lanugo covering other parts of the body. The cortical portion of the hair is composed of flat fusiform epithelial scales. The center of medullary portion consists of embryonic capsules, which are quite often pigmented, that give shade or color to the hair. It is closely connected with the amount of pigmentation in the skin. Gray and blonde hair has very little pigment. The hair follicle is in which the root is embedded is a pouch-like connective tissue structure consisting of three layers, the external, middle and internal. It consists of connective tissue containing an artery, vein and nerve. Nails are also modifications of the epidermis, differing from it by being harder and firmer. They are horny elastic translucent plates embodied in the skin and attached to the dorsum of the phalanges. They have four borders, the anterior being free, the posterior and lateral slightly curved longitudinally in their natural state, convex on their upper surface, but in the latent syphilitic patient they are spoon-shaped and flattened, very thin, having lost their natural curve. Nails are supposed to be modified portion of the stratum lucidum, beginning its function in the 3rd month of intrauterine life, and by the 8th month a greater part has developed. Physiology of the skin. An organ like the skin, of such complex and wonderful structure, could not possess a less wonderful and complex function. Usually the work of the internal organs is confined to one or two functions, but in the skin we find its functions are more varied and more numerous than that of any other organs in the body. Therefore, a study of its function is of even greater importance to the physician than its anatomy, who especially should be familiar with those internal disturbances of the life force that so frequently present themselves upon the external surface of the body or the skin. लाइक द बेरोमीटर इट शोज द राइज एंड फॉल ऑफ द माइटी डिस्टर्बिंग फोर्सेस विद इन दिस मे बी वेल इलस्ट्रेटेड इन अक्यूट एक्सैंथेमेटस डिजीज हाउ क्विकली डू वी सी द सर्कुलेटरी स्टॉर्म सबसाइड द गैस्ट्रिक और कैटरल सिम्टम्स ग्रो लेस एज सून एज द इरप्शन इज फुली डेवलप्ड अपॉन द स्किन नन द लेस ट्रू इज दिस इन मैनी ऑफ द डीप क्रॉनिक डिस्टर्बेंसेज बट हुज रिलेशनशिप इज नॉट सो क्लियरली शोन टू द अनट्रेंड ऑब्जर्वर ऑफ द मैनी ऑरिफेसिस ऑफ द स्किन फाइव स्पेशल वंस माइट बी मैंशन फर्स्ट इट प्रोटेक्ट्स द डीपर टिश्यूज एंड organs beneath as a garment it is folded and tucked about as protecting us from mechanical irritation the action of the atmosphere and irritating substances second as a sense organ third for the regulation of the temperature fourth as an organ of secretion and excretion including perspiration fifth absorption the fatty cushion in the connective tissues beside the elasticity and firmness of the corium modify the effects of blows and other mechanical injuries that might otherwise affect the internal organs or tissue beneath the nature and structure of the horny layer of the epidermis prevents the too rapid transudation and the evaporation of the fluids of the tissues otherwise the evaporation of the water of the fluids of the body would be continuous and to such an excess that the tissue would dry up and death be the result it further protects against irritating substances also high and low temperature however the regulation of the body's temperature is one of the most important offices of the skin maintaining it at a fixed standard the increase or decrease of a few degrees below or above normal being incompatible with life but owing to the power of resistance the skin is endowed with It is able to resist even greater variation each day. The skin, being a very imperfect conductor of heat, it therefore protects the body against heat and cold by the retention within the tissue of a considerable portion of the heat. It is said to have a separate apparatus for heat, cold, and pressure. Therefore, in an irritation of the skin, the sensation does not depend so much on the kind of irritation as upon the property of the nerve endings. The principal means of sustaining the normal standard of temperature is by the process of cutaneous transpiration by the impression of warm or hot air on the vasomotor nerves of the skin. The cutaneous muscles become relaxed, the blood vessels dilated and general superficies of the skin increased. The skin becomes suddenly bathed with perspiration and by means of rapid evaporation active heat is changed or converted into latent heat and the temperature of the perspiring surface rapidly diminishes this is more marked in humid air than in dry enabling one to endure a very high temperature in a dry air where he would not be able to endure such a temperature in a corresponding moist atmosphere as long as the perspiration is not interfered with a great degree of heat can be endured The sebaceous and sudoriferous glands perform the secretory and excretory functions of the skin. The sebum or sebaceous matter is a semi-fluid, oily matter consisting of vomiting olein, saponified fats and other fats of the body. Its principal purpose is its action as a lubricator, keeping the skin moist and pliable, and preventing a too rapid evaporation from cutaneous surfaces also protecting the skin against dampness or excessive moisture and external infection. The secretion of the sweat glands is a colorless fluid of a slightly salty taste, although it may be alkaline or acid in its reaction. Under certain pathological conditions, it is 99.5% water, with certain organic acids and a number of salts of the blood. It is quite volatile, easily evaporating. There are two forms of perspiration, the sensible and the insensible. The quantity excreted daily varies greatly in different persons, of course, influenced very much by their employment. But the average is from 1.5 to 2 pounds. It is controlled by the central nervous system, existing probably in the spinal cord and medulla. Absorption, the last function mentioned by means of which a great number of substances of a gaseous or medicinal nature are absorbed or carried into the circulation more especially by means of wearing apparel and by the never to be through नूबी नेवर टू बी थॉट ऑफ नॉक्सियस कस्टम ऑफ लोकल मेडिकेशन अपॉन द सर्फेस ऑफ द स्किन सच इज मर्करी क्विनाइन कैम्फर टर्पेंटीन आर्सेनिक एंड अदर सब्सटेंसेस. नेक्स्ट है सिम्टोमेटोलॉजी, ये हम पढ़ेंगे नेक्स्ट वीडियो में.